75 years ago, thousands of Americans became prisoners in their own land.
We were fenced in. We lost our freedom, emotionally and physically.
They were people of Japanese ancestry, mothers and fathers, students, farmers and business owners, locked up for years by their own government. Their only crime, they looked like the enemy.
How could I possibly conform to somebody saying, let's prove that you're a loyal American? My word, I've been a loyal American.
Some people say they can't believe it happened.
And I don't comprehend how that was able to happen, and other people let that happen.
This is a King 5 special report. Prisoners in their own land.
It was a tough time. Yeah. And it was even worse because they never said where we were going.
Sagebrush and tumbleweed and dusty in the summer and extremely cold and in the winter and muddy.
Incorrect propaganda and everything in racial prejudice. Oh, it was really something.
They weren't just camps, they were prisons, and they were treated as prisoners.
They are the haunting relics and replicas of a dark and shameful time. Minidoka, an American concentration camp in Idaho, now a national park where our education begins.
A date which will live in infamy.
The attack on Pearl Harbor by the Empire of Japan would catapult the United States into World War II and make Japanese Americans on the West Coast prisoners in their own land. Soon after the attack in Hawaii, scores of Japanese men all along the West Coast were taken from their homes. A curfew was imposed, affecting only people of Japanese ancestry. What happened next would surprise them all.
With a stroke of a pen, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt sent more than 110,000 Americans of Japanese ancestry into American concentration camps during World War II. Many of those uprooted from Western Washington ended up here in Minidoka, Idaho.
Executive Order 9066 allowed the Army to remove people of Japanese ancestry from the West Coast. The Army said they posed a military threat. Men, women, children, and old people had just 6 days to pack a single suitcase. They had to leave behind homes, crops, cars, radios, and pets. They were loaded onto buses and trains and shipped to desolate concentration camps. 62% of them were American citizens. No one was ever charged with espionage.
When I was younger, I had wished that someday I would ride a train.
Sumie Suguro Akizuki grew up on the family berry farm in Bellevue. She always dreamed of someday riding a train across the majestic Wilburton Trestle.
The irony is that my wish came true on May 20, 1942. We took the train at a station in Kirkland, Washington. We could take only what we could carry. As the train picked up speed, we went right past our farm, located next to the railroad tracks in Bellevue. We could see the neat rows of the strawberry fields and our house in the distance. The strawberries will be ready in just 2 weeks. It was going to be a good season. What seemed like an adventure was not at all like I thought it would be. It was a time of sadness and uncertainty.
The very first to be forced out of their homes, 276 people on Bainbridge Island. Kei Sakai Nakao was 22. They had 6 days to sell their things. Each person could bring just one suitcase.
If you put one overcoat in your suitcase, you can't put anything else in. So whatever you could wear, wear it.
Distraught islanders watched in disbelief as their classmates marched onto the ferry.
This is the day they left.
Mm-hmm.
You are taking away some of our very best friends.
Mary Woodward's parents, Walt and Millie Woodward, published the Bainbridge Review, which opposed the forced removal throughout the war.
It couldn't be clearer no person shall be deprived of life, liberty, and property without due process of law.
For taking that stand, she says some readers canceled their subscriptions to the Review, but not long after, her parents got a call.
They got a call from the druggist up the road who said, you know, Woody, you got to send more papers because we're selling out. In other words, the people canceled their subscriptions, but they still needed to read what was in the Review.
Most evacuees from Seattle were destined to spend the war years in Minidoka, Idaho, but they had to wait until the camp was built. They spent 6 months at the Puyallup Fairgrounds, living under the grandstands or in horse stalls. A PI reporter called it Camp Harmony.
When they went into the horse stalls, it had all just been whitewashed, so there were straw and bugs and spiders that were sticking to the walls.
And I was told I couldn't take any animals. I said, well, who's going to take care of Fluffy? And so my mother said she would buy enough food so that someone could take care of Fluffy for me. And I never saw Fluffy again.
This was someone who was 6 years old, having to live in a horse stall after stuffing her own mattress with straw.
Those who were feeble and exhausted from the ordeal.
In her personal slideshow, Dorothy Yamaguchi described what greeted incarcerees as they stepped off the bus in Minidoka.
The exterior walls of the barracks were covered with black tar paper. Inside, the walls consisted of exposed 2x4 studs and boards. The rain brought floods, and mud was everywhere.
Does anybody need sunscreen before we head out?
Okay, I'll catch up with you.
Who else is here for their first pilgrimage?
So how old were you when you were here?
Nine.
Nine.
Fumiko Ueda Groves has come back to Minidoka on a pilgrimage.
Can't remember walking this much. I remember it was far, but I guess when you're kids, you run, you don't walk.
Her father ran a hop store at Pike Place Market before the war and was whisked away to North Dakota soon after Pearl Harbor. The government considered him a detained alien enemy. It said so on his mail. Fumi, her mother, and brother went to live with 9,000 others at Minidoka.
It was cold in the winter and really hot in the summer, and there were dust storms and mud, lots of mud. But mostly it was cold. And this is where the guard tower was, right here.
Could you see the soldiers in there?
We did when we first came.
Apartment size was 24 feet by 20 feet, and that was for families of 6 and up.
On the pilgrimage, Fumi meets her third grade classmate, Teru Shibata. He marvels how the parents kept their suffering to themselves.
They never let on, right? They never told the kids, oh, this is terrible.
It's just come on, you know,
Ishikata.
It can't be helped. We just got to accept it. And there's nothing that we could do.
And then there's gaman.
Gaman is to endure.
I got a better understanding about my dad, why he was so angry.
Don Shimono of Bellevue was an infant in Minidoka. And only now at the pilgrimage does he understand why his father was so bitter.
They lost all their property, they lost their jobs, they lost their friends.
What would you like to say to him if he was here?
Oh my God. When I went to his funeral, I sat there and I talked to him and I thanked him for everything, all the suffering that he had to go through and all the pain that he had to go through to make us survive. And I realized all the price that he had to pay in life that he lost because of the internment camp.
Why didn't they object? Why go along with an unconstitutional scheme? Some people did object, and incredibly, others volunteered to serve in the U.S. Army. Warriors and resistors dividing the Japanese-American community. A loyalty questionnaire in 1943 challenged the incarcerees. Question 27 asked, will you volunteer for combat? Some said, no, not until you release my family. Question 28 asked, will you swear allegiance to the United States and forswear any obedience to the Japanese emperor? Some said, no, I never swore allegiance to the emperor. I'm an American. Even one no could raise eyebrows in the Japanese community. Jim Akutsu was a UW sophomore in 1942 when he tried to enlist, but was classified 4C, enemy alien.
I had never pledged allegiance to Japan, flag, or the emperor, see? And if I felt that I had answered it yes, I would be incriminating myself.
When the government reversed course and began drafting Japanese Americans again, some incarcerees resented having to prove their Americanness. In various camps, hundreds of draft-age men protested. Men like Frank Yamasaki were tried as draft resistors and sent to federal prison for 2 years.
This honor hurts, and it still hurts. How could I possibly conform to somebody saying, let's prove that you're a loyal American? My word, I've been a loyal American.
For decades growing up, the only accepted response to incarceration was contained in two phrases. Shikatakunai, Japanese for it can't be helped, passive resignation in the face of oppression. The other was go for broke, Hawaiian pidgin for give 110%.
Seattle journalist Frank Abe documented the resistors.
So between shikatakunai and go for broke, there was no room for a third reality, which was resistance in the face of oppression.
Those who answered yes, yes, went on to volunteer for the U.S. Army or military intelligence service, becoming the most decorated, segregated unit in Army history.
I volunteered from a relocation center to show my loyalty and to prove that I had the right to live as a good American citizen.
Six Purple Hearts, a Bronze Star and a Silver Star.
Staff Sergeant Shiro Kishino was typical of those who served in the 442nd Regimental Combat Team. Injured multiple times, Kishino was always sent back to the front for the next seemingly impossible task. His daughter Debbie remembers.
Because collectively, their courage and their bravery and their willingness to fight during a time that this country has turned their backs on them, I think, is really what this is about.
And in a cruel irony, Nisei soldiers, whose own families remained locked up in America, helped liberate the death camp at Dachau.
Four of my brothers were serving in the U.S. military, defending America, while the rest of their family was incarcerated in a prison camp.
Meanwhile, back in Seattle, Gordon Hirabayashi was a 23-year-old UW undergraduate who defied the curfew in 1942.
I had some kind of a student idealistic notion that the Constitution meant something.
His case went all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court, where he lost. He spent months at the King County Jail, McNeil Island, and assorted lockups. It took until the early 80s to change the Supreme Court ruling. New evidence of a government cover-up emerged, and a team of young volunteer attorneys decided to take on the Attorney General's office. Lead attorney, Rod Kawakami.
Well, we're hoping that whatever we lack in experience, we can make up in hard work and enthusiasm.
This time, a federal judge in Seattle vacated Hirabayashi's conviction. In 2012, he was posthumously awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the nation's highest civilian award.
Life for incarcerees here was difficult and depressing, but what awaited some incarcerees when they left was even worse. Coming up, the hard road back.
If racism was bad before the war with Japan, it was probably worse after it. Lily Kitamoto Kodama, fresh out of Minidoka, recalls the sting of racism as a young girl walking with her mom to the ferry.
This man came up behind us and said, "Why don't you go back where you came from, you blankety-blank Japs?" And I immediately turning around to tell him, "I'm not a Jap, I'm an American." Mama grabbed my arm and said, "Don't talk to him, just ignore him, keep walking."
It was difficult to find housing, jobs, and for Taki Kimura, self-respect.
Being of Japanese extraction, after Pearl Harbor and all that, I was beat up and chased down the street and called a goddamn Jap and all that, and it just destroyed me.
The war kept Kimura from attending WSU. He ended up working at the family grocery when he said a customer saved him from despair. That customer? Martial artist Bruce Lee.
Bruce was the guy that came into my life, and even though he's young enough to be my son, he was so wise in the philosophical essence that he kept working on me and telling me that I was just as good as him or anybody else.
Kimura taught at Lee's martial arts school and tends his grave to this day.
It was squeaky when we lived here.
After the war, it was difficult for Japanese Americans to find work and places to live.
That was a really godsend that we were able to come here.
Shokichi Tokita's family could only find housing in the Seattle Japanese Language School. Classrooms turned into apartments, costing families $6 a month. They call the school the Hunt Hotel, since most of the residents came from the Minidoka camp near Hunt, Idaho. The best thing about this home?
How convenient is that? Just walk out your door and here you are.
That's right. What a huge change from camp. And a luxury.
But not everyone recovered from the trauma. National Park Service historian Elisa Law says three people committed suicide here.
That kind of gives you an idea of how devastated people were and how hopeless the situation seemed coming back.
The last tenant left after 14 years. For decades, those who were locked up in American wartime concentration camps knew it was wrong. But what to do about it? It took a Boeing engineer from Seattle and a cohort of civil liberties friends to stand up and seek redress. Tom Ikeda, executive director of history website Densho, theorizes it came down to one man who pushed the idea. Henry Miyatake was 13 when he went to Minidoka.
He was this Boeing engineer, really smart.
But it took the threat of a layoff to get him motivated.
Because Henry was so good, they said, well, we want to keep you, but we're going to cut your pay like in half. And Henry said, you can't do that. You know, I'm not going to do that. But his manager said, yes, you will. You're Japanese American. And I know what happened during World War II. And the Japanese Americans just took it and didn't complain. And so the same way with the other Japanese American engineers, I know if we just give you half your salary, you guys would just take it.
It took me about a year before I got to the point of saying, hey, we're going to do something.
Miyatake and the Seattle Japanese American Citizens League went to work using flip charts to educate the public and their fellow incarcerees about the fight ahead. Amazingly, some in the community resisted.
Some have likened it and have mentioned that it's somewhat like being raped. You know it was wrong, but you've been raped and you don't like to tell people about the fact that you've been raped.
Fortunately, there were four Japanese American lawmakers in Washington, D.C. who would help craft a path to redress. Congressman Bob Matsui and Norm Mineta, and Senators Spark Matsunaga and Daniel Inouye, himself a World War II vet. They helped create a federal commission on wartime relocation and internment of civilians, which went to several cities, including Seattle, to collect testimony and information about the massive denial of civil liberties. For some, it was the first time they had talked about their incarceration in almost 40 years.
The feeling of being pointed out as an enemy during a crucial period of my life and without a chance to defend myself caused many psychological wounds from which I feel I have never recovered.
In its final report, the commission concluded that the incarceration of Japanese Americans was not based on military necessity, but was the result of race prejudice, war hysteria, and a failure of political leadership. When Congress finally voted in the fall of 1987, Washington State's delegation unanimously supported it 10-0. The signing of the redress bill by President Ronald Reagan in 1988 capped more than 10 years of hard work. It provided $20,000 to each survivor, a public education fund, and a formal apology.
No payment can make up for those lost years. So what is most important in this bill has less to do with property than with honor. For here, we admit a wrong.
Today is a vindication for Japanese Americans, for the Constitution,
and for all Americans.
The government began issuing checks to the oldest survivors first. When asked what he thought of redress, one elderly gentleman said, "It takes a great country to admit it made a mistake."
Coming up, can this happen again? Some final thoughts from those who were prisoners in their own land.
Ladies and gentlemen, could you please find your seats? We would like to start the program. Please give regard to our elders to proceeding.
I'm a descendant of a family imprisoned in Block 14, Barrack 10.
Forward, march.
Family number 11755.
As the pilgrimage draws to a close, a salute to those who've passed, and a promise.
Your struggle has not, nor will be, forgotten.
Forgotten? The next generation worries and vows to protect groups who may become targets. Dale Watanabe of the Minidoka Pilgrimage Organizing Committee.
The experience of these camps may be in the past, but I'm afraid I see it happening again right now. Groups are being targeted because of who they are. Racial profiling is ugly. You may just find you have something in common with your Muslim neighbor, and you can learn from each other and find a very powerful ally.
America's a great country, but it still makes mistakes.
Line up straight in the line. Ready.
It wasn't an internment camp. It was an American concentration camp.
Present arms.
America is awesome, but it does make errors.
So we hope that you, as our future leaders, will remember this story and never let it happen again.
It shouldn't happen again in America.
On this 75th anniversary of the President's executive order, the biggest takeaway is that our country must never forget the lessons of this dark and shameful period. We must always be vigilant of our constitutional rights as a tribute to all of those whose lives were touched by Executive Order 9066. Thanks for watching.